Hi, you guys, I'm Mad Maxx, and we are back in Las Vegas for with Big Matt and his series, Real Life with MPA, The Inside Scoop, episode 10, Big Matt.
Yeah.
Already.
Flying.
Crazy. We just came back from the Arnold. Great showing for you and your team. Natalia, of course, snagging the first place in her category. How was the Arnold for you guys?
It was good. Super action-packed. First year, I went without my wife. She's usually a big help. But stayed busy the whole time, had really good help and workers. Natalia was a highlight, obviously. But it was great, you know. It was kind of interesting because it was our first time away from my baby, which is hard. But overall, it was a good experience.
How proud were you of Natalia? She killed it, man. You guys did so well.
You know, with her, it's she likes to, you know, whenever we go back and forth in her emails, she likes to push it. And her conditioning is always spot on. But I always want to land that plane, I say, right on time, because I want to peak her right on time, because if she's super, super shredded too early, I don't want her to go flat. So the way she came down and peaked was just awesome. So I think it was her best look. I think she was, I want to say, 4 to 5 pounds heavier than the Olympia.
Wow.
And her conditioning is, you know, spot on.
So. That's awesome. Well, congratulations again. Yeah. And it was nice to have Jay. Congratulations in person. Oh, that was the last episode. That was so cool.
Nothing feels better than having Jay Cutler come and congratulate you and actually recognize you.
That's awesome. I'm glad you had the time to do that. So I want to go back a little bit today to the beginning. And I know we spoke about this briefly in episode one, but not everybody's seen all the show. And I really want to, I think this is important. We're going to talk about, and I want to talk about how all this came about, you know, you becoming a coach, you becoming, you know, the owner of your, and founder of, you know, your co-founder of your supplement company. You started at Max Muscle just like I did years ago. And I'm assuming you started to work for Max Muscle because they have really good product. I don't know how big they are anymore, but they have really good brand. And I found for myself that whenever, because I've been a trainer way back in the day, and I found that being in a store, to me, it was kind of like an extension of being a personal trainer or coach or something like that, because people always come in with no knowledge about anything as far as supplements. They want to know what to use so they can actually get in better shape, how to use it. And it's more, to me, the job of an educator. I'm assuming you did the same.
You know, actually, my foundation started even before Max Muscle. I used to manage some vitamin shops.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Yeah, you've done demos there.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I did vitamin shop when I was literally probably 21. So, or even actually 20 years old. And I was there till quite a few years. And then I, you know, did a couple other things and landed at Max Muscle eventually. But from even Vitamin Shop, honestly, like, they're so adamant about education with nutrition and supplementation. They even make you take courses. It's called like Vitamin Shop University or VSU. So I had to take courses in different modules and actually pass them.
Wow.
And this is not regarding just sports nutrition. This is herbs, botanicals, vitamins. So a lot of wide array of things.
Yeah.
And in fact, they even have you fly you out to New Jersey to the headquarters, and you have to go through like assimilation, like a series of tests in front of like the CEO and different head honchos.
Wow.
And do essays. It's like, it's really extensive. So
I didn't know that.
Yeah, I actually went through all that through Vitamin Shop and had a really good time there. But you know, like you're saying, a lot of people just walk in there, not know anything. They'll hear from a magazine or someone at work, you know, I need to get on the new nitric oxide product. You know, and then your first question would be like, well, are you taking a protein? No. Are you eating protein? Well, I eat a sandwich at lunch, and then I have some nuts at my snack. So, I mean, you have people that just don't know anything, and they go in right out the gate and not know what to get. And so it was always my job to be very honest with them, and I'd always try to steer them in the right direction. And it wouldn't be to, okay, well, I'm going to upsell them on a nitric oxide product plus a pre-workout stimulant. No, it'd be, let's address your nutrition. Let's actually really go over it. I'm going to have them actually, you know, repeat their entire day if they can rehearse it. And then I'm going to go and correct that and start from there. And, you know, like we were talking off camera, sometimes they might leave the store with no product, but that's okay. They're going to leave the store with, okay, I need to start with my diet, breakfast, you know, a snack, lunch, snack, dinner, 5 meals a day. And kind of go from there. So it was all about an honesty thing, you know?
And they came back, I'm sure.
Yeah, they would come back and they'd appreciate it. But it would then, you know, wind up maybe ending in more sales because now they want, okay, I've done the diet thing for a couple of weeks or months. Now I got the protein. Now I got the creatine. Now I might try some essential amino acids. Maybe I need a fat burner because I'm trying to cut body fat. So then you'd build their basket basically each time they came in.
That's right.
So you implanted that seed, you know, that trust, that bond, and then they know you actually have integrity, And then you actually have a good loyal customer, right?
That's right.
Instead of just like, okay, I'm a car salesman or con man, and I'm just, let's sell you this, this, this. Then they walk out of there with stimulants and stuff they don't even know how to use. And they're going to burn out and probably not go to the gym because they feel like terrible from whatever product.
Or they'll have a buyer's guilt. They go back home. They just spent $300. What the hell did I do? And they bring back all that stuff. That happens also.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Several times.
Yeah.
Yeah. So that happened at the vitamin shop. Then once again, like we were talking, you know, Max Muscle, same type of thing. Even more personalized with Max Muscle because it's a smaller store. Yeah. Usually less busy. I don't want to speak for all locations or franchises. But yeah, you build up even a more personal relationship with Max Muscle, I think. And they're more geared towards sports nutrition.
Yeah.
Whereas Vitamin Shop, I get elderly people for antioxidants and essential fatty acids and other stuff. I would say sports nutrition for Vitamin Shop made up only about 30% of the store.
Wow.
But with Max Muscle, it was more like 80%.
Yeah.
Right?
That's right.
So, yeah.
Because Max Muscle was less busy, like you said, so you actually developed your career as a prep coach a lot in there. And that's when you kind of started your name as being, you know, one of the top coaches in the industry, right?
Yeah, so I was building up my name locally years even before Max Muscle, obviously, and within my town in Portland, Oregon. And then I started going more online. When we talked about the first episode,
yeah.
I worked for Primordial Performance, a supplement company.
Right.
And I was a forum marketing manager. So I went on the bodybuilding discussion forums with my name, real name, not alias, real picture, and just talk about the product, but intertwined knowledge about nutrition,
nice. You
know, chemicals, etc., and built up a lot of rapport with the members, and then it kind of circulated throughout the internet, and I was getting a lot of inquiries. I started working nationally online. So it was Primordial, and then over to Max Muscle, I worked there next, and then, of course, I was juggling both.
Wow. You know? So, you know, you probably realize real quick by being in a Max Muscle, then actually people, once they realize, you know, what you're talking about, they're like, okay, well, so aside from that, tell me what I can use. I'll trust you. Just let me know so eventually, once you start selling somebody else's brand, you're like, you know what? I'm an idiot. I could probably make my own stuff, which I really believe in. I know what's good, the right dosage, which is what brought us into MPA approved, you know, so it's kind of why you started the company. I mean, aside from the fact that, I know, I remember you said you wanted to get signed and all that stuff. You said, you know what, I may as well just do my own thing.
Yeah.
But the real reason, I would think, is because you want to, for yourself and also other people, steer them in the direction of something that you really believe in, that you know is working and has the right. Because it's not just to take, you know, glutamine once in a while and creatine once in a while and BCA here and there. Supplements are timely. And if you're not using them at the proper time, at the proper dosage, it doesn't work nearly as well.
Yeah.
So talk about that.
Yeah, I mean, so working at Max Muscle definitely played a role in me wanting to develop my own. There's a lot of good products there, and I think Max Muscle brand, you know, they do everything third-party tested. All the ingredients are DSHEA compliant, all that stuff. They're compatible with colleges and sports. But, you know, there are just some things that I want to take above and beyond what I saw there. At the end of the day, a lot of these companies that are big corporations, they want to make money, right? So my whole shtick was, I have coaching as like my main income. So if I come out with a supplement company, I'm not trying to kill it with just making a ton of cash, immediately burn and turn and freaking just grab my money and leave. I want to do something different and basically don't really prioritize the profit that much and just put out this awesome product with these name branded ingredients, super high clinical doses, just stuff that's not too common. Very rare, actually. You go and look at other products, labels, I mean, you'll find very few that are able to match mine, and I don't think they'll exceed it, put it that way. But like I said, it's just because I've been in a position where I feel I'm blessed to not rely on that income. So I thought it'd be cool to just put out a product line that stood kind of on its own, and I really think it has. So yeah, that's kind of what happened. You know, I just wanted to have my own line that I felt was truly the gold standard.
It's kind of nice to start a supplement company but not really needed the money. I mean, of course, we all do it for profit,
right.
But it's not the main reason, like you said.
Yeah, I don't want it to sound like I'm just like rich or this. I'm very basic where like I have one car, like I don't live out of my means. I'm very frugal and I'm very cautious with my money, but you know, I live normal. But having that supplement income from the supplement company definitely helps, but it wasn't my whole like objective. Just I gotta just kill it.
Yeah, let's make 10 million the first year.
Let's come out with this awesome product line, and have the greatest ingredients. Then kind of as we get popular, let's shift out and like take away the name branded ingredients. Let's source out from China or Portugal or India or wherever, get a little
more
cheaper,
yeah.
Increase that profit margin. But now the buyer's already hooked. And maybe some of them aren't knowledgeable, so they don't even know what the product's being changed.
Yeah.
I never want to do that.
Yeah.
You know, and if we were to ever switch out a name branded ingredient, I would inform everyone first and be like, hey, you know, to bring the cost down so you guys are more able to buy this, we're going to actually take out this name brand ingredient, put in something a little cheaper. If you guys are cool with it, we're going to make sure it's tested and pure.
So it'll be transparent.
Exactly.
Yeah. Awesome. Yeah. Okay. So I want you to talk about the basics. You know, so let's assume that whoever's watching the video right now doesn't know anything about supplements. They're just getting started into bodybuilding and they're like, you know what? I don't know what the hell I'm doing. What should I do when I first get started, whether to be to put on some muscle or to lose some body fat, which is always, of course, the two scenario you always get at the beginning.
Lose fat, gain muscle simultaneously.
Well,
it's the dream.
Yeah. Right? And most people don't think like it's possible.
Hey, man, I want to lose fat and gain muscle. Well, you can lose fat and gain muscle, A, if you're a new trainee and the stimulus is fresh to the muscle, you have no set nutrition, or B, you're anabolically assisted, right? But...
Hey. It's my wife. Not for you, I think.
Repeat the question because I lost my train of thought.
So, yeah, what would you say to someone? What would you suggest for someone who's just getting into into this and they're like, okay, well, just I don't know anything about anything.
Yeah,
so, teach me the basics.
Yeah, it was funny. So I'll just use myself as an example. When I first started in high school, the big thing was CellTech by Muscle Tech.
Yeah, that's right.
Like 98, 99 into 2001. I didn't know any better. So instead of getting a protein powder, which I learned later should be the foundation staple, I got CellTech first before a protein. So... but it definitely is an effective product, the creatine monohydrate, but definitely a protein powder, which is such a common answer. I mean, people probably expect that, but really it's true. I mean, what builds muscle is protein, also amino acids within the protein, which assimilates and then you build muscle tissue. So definitely high quality protein should be first and foremost. Very basic. Whey isolate, of course, if you can afford it, just because you're not going to get, you know, the trace lactose that could upset your stomach and you don't want bloating and flatulence and all that bad stuff. And then after that, like going back to the CellTech, I think creatine monohydrate is tried and true. It's proven. There's a lot of clinical research to show that it's proven. I know there's a lot of different creatine forms that are out now, creatine hydrochloride. There's been crealkaline. Mm-hmm. Then back in the day, there was creatine ethyl ester, which actually was proven to be bunk because it turned into creatinine almost instantaneously, which is a byproduct.
Oh, wow.
But just the tried and true. I mean, if people want to get fancy with these new age creatines to improve upon it. But creatine monohydrate, man, it's basic and it's tried and true. You know, so protein, so whey isolate, a creatine monohydrate. Then after that, if you want to even enhance recovery even more, I think essential amino acids. So an EAA product.
Nice. You
know, those three really like...
would be the basics.
I think they're the basics. You know, you can go into pre-workouts. And I sell a pre-workout. It's a great one. But I'm not going to be like, hey, you need this.
You don't start there. You don't start there.
I'm not going to ever just throw that into someone.
Well,
someone's playing.
There's different kinds of protein out there. So, and I know that they don't all taste good. You have a new one. I mean, you have a protein powder also, but I'm just going to talk about it because I love that one. It's that ISO poof over there, which is, this is a new flavor.
Oh, yeah.
The French toast flavor that just came out. And right. You were nice enough to give me a couple of boxes of those, and it tastes unbelievable. And what's great about it is that there's actually virtually no carbs, no sugar, all protein. I eat that as my pre-workout at the gym.
Yeah.
And with my protein powder, people are like, what the hell are you doing? You're eating poofs? You're eating like... So it's the corn thing, you know, the box.
It looks like the
so chips. That's actually a great alternative if you do like cereal or if you, you know, not to use nut protein powder, but talk about that. It's a really cool
product. Yeah, so, you know, we did come out with the IsoPoofs, which is a protein cereal, so... they're basically, I want to make a cereal you could eat and ingest that feels like you're eating carbs, but you're not. And it's protein based, which is, you know, like Dave said, it's virtually fat free. It's 1 gram of fat. It's under 1 gram of sugar, and it's 17 to 19 grams of protein, depending on the flavor.
That's awesome.
This is the new French Toast Crunch.
I noticed it's less protein by 2 grams.
Yeah, it is. No, we're very precise with the nutrition facts. So if something's like, you know, half or a quarter gram off, we're going to list it.
Yeah.
The apple cinnamon flavor is the original, which is also good. But I think the French toast has been getting even better feedback.
Wow.
And then, you know, to coincide with that, of course, the Isosolve, which is graham cracker pie crust. So the graham cracker pie crust is a hit, especially if you're dieting and you're hungry and you want to fulfill a sweet tooth. So it's just a cold filter, whey protein isolate, and the taste is really good.
How does that taste, the two of them together?
I don't know. I'd never combine them.
Like, really? I would do that.
You know, with the Isopoofs, it's like kind of your choice. You can choose whatever milk product you want. Like, you know, if you're dieting, you're probably not going to choose milk.
No.
Multitude of reasons, because it has extra carbs, sugar, and then it's lactose. But you can use like almond milk, which is like 35 calories.
I use protein powder.
Or
to
you
add
use protein
to it.
Powder with water and more protein. Yeah. Egg whites that are pasteurized with like water. I always do that.
Mm.
So anything. There's actually something called oat milk from oatmeal, which is kind of weird.
I saw that post you made on that.
It tastes really good, but it does have some carbs naturally. So yeah, it's all kind of in your, it's your prerogative what you want to mix with it.
Nice.
But yeah, I mean, those two products, man, are basic, and that's what I wanted to come out with, you know, just basic products.
Awesome. Talk about creatine and talk about, okay, so we talk about protein a little bit. Of course, the amount of protein that will be required is different from one person to the next. But if you could give an average, someone who's never dieted, who's never did bodybuilding, what would you say an average is every 3 hours they should be at least consuming just to get started?
An average, I would say 40 grams per meal.
Okay. I used to say 25 to 30, so you're still a little higher. 40
yeah, a little higher. I mean, if they're a new trainee, I mean, they want to gain utmost muscle tissue. I mean, I'd rather overshoot protein than to undershoot it.
Yeah.
But like everyone, you know, not everyone, but some people know that, you know, it depends on your other macronutrients. So if you have protein, you know, at 300 grams, that's probably fine if your carbs are low, your fat's low. But if you have your other macros higher, like fats and carbs, the protein can be a little lower because it obviously spares
you
know, protein. So I'd rather overshoot protein than to underdo it.
Just, okay, good.
You know, and protein's a hard macronutrient to actually metabolically shift and convert over to glucose and actually store it as fat. It's kind of a metabolic process. It's not efficient. It's inefficient. So your body really doesn't have a likelihood to store it as fat compared to other macros.
Yeah, I used to tell the people. So, so let's say around 40 grams is your advice.
40 grams, what I would recommend.
Awesome.
Good. It's pretty safe.
Let's talk about creatine.
Sure.
When is the best time to use creatine? Why is yours so good? And why? And when should you be taking it for optimal results?
So like we talked off camera, my product is CreRibovol, which is 10 grams of CreaPure, which is German-grade creatine monohydrate, very pure, micronized, has some other goodies in there too. So the best time to take creatine, just from what I've done personally, anecdotally, and then of course from research, is post-workout, right? Post-workout, obviously, your muscle cells are really receptive to absorb nutrition. GLUT4 transporter proteins, which is located inside the muscle cell, non-insulin dependent. So even without insulin or sugar to stimulate that, your muscles naturally are going to basically have an uptake or a vacuum effect to take up glucose, creatine, ribose, what have you. So post-workout's like the magic. They call it the anabolic window. People make fun of that. There's some truth to it because of that. So like whenever you have mechanical tension from resistance training, you do something awesome to your muscle cells that make them really receptive after the post-workout period.
So, but creatine is supposed to help you with strength and power while you train. So shouldn't you take it before?
Well, it's a storage effect.
So okay,
you're gonna super compensate.
Tomorrow.
The creatine, the ATP, creatine phosphate, all that good stuff, glucose, glycogen. Then the next workout, you're loaded, right? Deplete.
Even though it's the next day.
Right, absolutely.
Okay.
Now, I've done creatine intra-workout, pre-workout. Some people get stomach issues, gastrointestinal issues.
Okay.
But yeah, post-workout, I really think that's kind of, it's old school, but in my opinion, it's the best way to do it.
Okay, good. I'm glad you said that. Okay.
For sure.
What else? Aminos?
Yeah,
okay, good.
Your essential amino acids, which I've talked about this before.
Yeah.
The farm grade is your EAAs. Which the EAAs are, you know, 9 essential amino acids. Within the 9, there's the 3 BCAAs within that. Of course, my product, I want the best. So I have the Ajinomoto pharmaceutical grade quality amino acids. But once again, protein, creatine, then like thirdly, I would do an EAA.
Okay.
Okay. So if like you have like only a limited budget, protein, knock that out of the way. And then, okay, you have a little bit more money, creatine. Then if you have a little extra money, do the EAAs. So just being honest, you know.
Yeah, I like what you're saying.
So with the EAAs, once again, anti-catabolic, helps with recovery. You could use it intra-workout's a good time because they're free-form, they're pre-digested, so there should be not a lot of blood pooling in your stomach. It should be really efficient.
Okay.
Slow you down at all.
Optimal dosage.
So I have 13 grams for a serving. I think that's a good dose.
Okay.
Usually you want the leucine content to be above 3 grams, which stimulates protein synthesis.
Okay.
So mine's 6 grams, so I doubled it. just to be sure.
Okay.
So yeah, as long as your product, your EAAs has a 3 gram or more ratio of leucine, I think you're good to go.
I'm glad you said that. Okay, yeah. Cool. And then lastly, you have something else here, cellulose.
Oh, so cellulose. And then once again, like I said, protein, creatine, EAAs. Now, if you just have, you know, you made
a bonus that
work
month.
Overtime, yeah. Got some time and a half.
Yeah.
Cellulose is a great pre-workout. It's non-stim because that's what I use. I don't like being jittery. I don't like stimulating cortisol levels, my blood pressure, all that stuff. So this is non-stim. You can certainly add caffeine to it or whatever you want to get your heart rate up or whatever. But this product is solely just for muscle swelling, pump from the nitrosamine, the citrulline. Everything's mega-dosed, one serving. It's a 20-gram scoop, so it's pretty big. And you do that pre-workout. I do that about 15 minutes prior.
Nice.
So more blood flow, vascularity. My muscle connection is probably a little better.
Awesome. So technically, that would be your protein, the pre-workout, the intra-workout, yeah, and the pulse workout, which would be the creatine.
And we talked about the creatine. Like I told you off camera, Dave, Karabival, we're going to reformulate that.
Okay.
So we discontinued that. Unfortunately, it was just such a high-priced product, so my cost was so high, and then we had to retail it for a decently high price. So I don't think it was selling as well as it could have. But it is what it is. I mean, I wanted to use the best ingredients and unfortunately, I'm going to try to scale back and reformulate it, make it maybe a little bit more simplified, and come back out with a creatine product.
Okay,
so it's not available. A lot of people are going to be mad. They love the creatine.
It's not available right now, but it's temporary, right?
Yeah, temporary. I'm going to come back out with a creatine product since, you know, the creatine now is sold out.
All right. You guys, go on Matt's YouTube channel. Like we said before, he's got a ton of content that he's been shooting for a long time. You're going to find some gems on there. What we do here is only every 2 weeks, so it's very limited. But if you want to learn more about his theory, his training, his nutrition, stuff that he's done personally, go on his YouTube channel. Of course, his Instagram, which is Matt Porter Approve. And then check out the website, you guys. Yeah. MPA Subs.
Yep, right? MPASubs.com.
There you go. All right, thanks, Big Matt. All right, Big Matt, you get one good question from your viewers out there. Let's hear it.
All right. JWP2014 says, rolling into the 2019 season for bodybuilding, who do you have as your top favorites to be competitive at the Olympia this year, as well as any new guys who you think could do some damage this year? All right, so I wish I had like a list and pictures next to me, but I can base things kind of off the Arnold, which just happened, the Australia Arnold and the Columbus Arnold. So favorites, obviously, Sean Roden, right? Now, I honestly think that Sean's going to have it on lockdown. I people are going to argue and say, well, you know, he just was at the right time, right place. Phil was off. But, you know, a lot of other guys could beat him. I personally, you know, I was given that Sean can rekindle his fullness and size again, and then, of course, whittle it down to that perfect condition that he displays, which is amazing. Sean gets granite hard. He gets separated. He pops. He has crazy striations. His midsection's crazy. I don't think the current crop right now will be able to beat him if Sean Roden does come back with the same fullness or more, because he needs more fullness, obviously, shoulders and arms, back. But as long as he comes with the same or better and then the same conditioning, I don't see anyone dethroning him. So we'll just say that's that. Now, far as new people, I don't really see any new guys. I mean, Luke Sando just did the Arnold Australia and Columbus and finally nailed it. He looked phenomenal. I would like to see Luke in the top 10, maybe top 8.
You know, he got fifth in Australia, right?
He got fifth in Australia and he got, third in Columbus.
Yeah, yeah.
So I actually had him third in Australia too.
Okay.
Based off the video, absolutely.
Okay.
No offense to Ruly. It was not Ruly.
Not his year. Yeah.
Not the Ruly we're used to seeing. It was like Ruly like years ago type Ruly. So Luke could be in the top 8. As far as like being in the top 5, Nathan Diasha could definitely be in the top 5. Now what I like about Nathan is X frame, small waist, wasp waist, full muscle bellies. And I think he actually is bigger. He has, like, I heard back in 2016, he only weighed 225 pounds at the Cal Pro.
Wow.
And I thought he would have been 240. So he has that illusion of like a Flex Wheeler where he's full and round and is bigger than he actually weighs. So the only knock on Nathan, in my opinion, is the knock on him, if it sounds kind of weird, the knock on him is also his strength. Whereas he has the high lats, but that insinuates his wasp waist and his X-frame. But then the judges, that can kind of hurt him because he's not as complete as like a William Boniak whose lats connect to his hips.
Mm.
But Nathan has that cool look.
Yeah.
So
his strength is kind of a weakness. It's kind of a weird thing. If he can just stay tight with the waist and keep building his frame with more mass and still keep that aesthetic, he's top five material for sure.
How do you think about, what do you think about Brandon winning the Arnold and rolling to the Olympia? Curry.
Oh yeah. Curry is awesome. I think, like people have said, Curry might be Sean's biggest threat, because if you're going apples to apples, Brandon has that upper body fullness that maybe Sean might be a little slight on. Sean's legs, in my opinion, destroy. Sean's glutes look like they're dug out with a spoon. Yeah. His hamstring tie-in looks like it's scraped out too. Yeah. So it's a top versus bottom. Mm-hmm. But also Sean's conditioning is a little bit more prevalent, meaning that it looks, and you know, Sean, what, past 40, but he has that conditioning and that pop on stage that looks vibrant and young, that snap, that pop of the muscle when people flex comes to life. Sean has that still.
He's wide too.
So then I want to say about William, much respect to him. I think he's an awesome bodybuilder. Not my cup of tea, but it's all subjectivity, right? Yeah. To me, he's a ball of muscle. He's real bunchy, scrunched up, not the widest guy, not missing anything. There's no gaps. But I just think that he's just not spread out enough. Yeah. I wish he's a little wider and a little taller.
But compact.
He's very compact. Yeah. But he's always going to be a threat in the top five with that conditioning and muscle. Yeah. But as far as him dethroning Sean or anything like that, I just don't think that's the direction that they would award.
Yeah.
Josh Leonardowitz, awesome guy. Physique's great. Looks like he kind of, this is just my opinion, at the Columbus Arnold, looks like he didn't really want to zero in on the conditioning and like nail it. He was really big and full and overwhelming, but the backside, the lower back, upper glutes were a little bit loose. Then it looks like he might have overcompensated for the Australia, because then he looked like he was a lot leaner in those areas, but he lost a little bit of that snap to his legs. Yeah. His quads looked a little washed out. The sweeps were not as prominent. So he just needs to find that fine balance, to where he doesn't rush anything and like lose that, but he also comes in on time.
Yeah.
Maybe a little bit more chest fullness, because I know he has a little bit of a genetic issue where like there's space, but if he can fill that in even more with more density, he's great, man. He reminds me of like a 90s, like a Mike Francois with size. Gunter, like all, you know, those taller, bigger guys. He's one of them.
Yeah.
So he could definitely be easily top six.
Yeah.
If he nails it.
Yeah.
Who else am I missing? But yeah, so, I mean, and then Rami, of course, everyone. Of course. Same thing with Rami. I'm not even going to say it. Come in conditioning, come in separated. Yeah. Imagine Rami with Sean Roden's separation.
Forget it.
Mr. Olympia, right? Yeah,
forget it.
Yeah, and then other than that, Rolly, once again, my opinion, I'm just not the biggest fan of his physique. Yeah. I love his pictures in the mirror. And in Kuwait, the Kuwait mirrors are doing most musculars. I love his crazy pictures.
Yeah.
When it's on stage, the quads, for whatever reason, I know they're huge in person, but just the way they flow and like the lack of like separation and detail makes him look a little bit up and down with his huge upper body. And I'm a big believer in eye candy. So the centerpiece of your physique is your ab wall. And if your ab wall is kind of flat with not a lot of crazy detail, I don't get drawn to you. So with Rolly, he doesn't have a lot of serratus intercostal and crazy delineation. Whenever he hits his shots, his quarter turns and stuff, there's this kind of blank. The canvas is blank, right?
Yeah.
Roden, crazy abdominal wall.
Yeah.
Brandon Curry, abdominal wall. Yeah. William Boniek, abdominal wall.
That's a good, that's Dexter good
Jackson.
Yeah.
That's going to draw me to those guys, even though they're smaller. That ab and thigh, man, I think, in my opinion, I don't think he could, or he should, in my opinion, win the O.
Yeah.
I don't care if he's big.
Yeah.
Doesn't matter.
Cool. I think that was a good question, a good answer.
Thank you.
All right, thanks, buddy.